our ISTEM supported hands-on training on column chromatography and photoelectric. So both these two instruments are available to us. So you are familiar, and probably some of you have seen also column chromatography and photoelectric. Although you have seen, there are certain techniques and tips that one research scholar should know while handling this tools. Because for our theoretical knowledge, we know what is chromatography or we know what is evaporation. So we have divided our training program in two sections, two new tools. From first, like from today onwards, for 3 days, like 4, 5, and 6, we will be discussing on column chromatography. So what is column chromatography? How to tap the column? What are the principles and what are the tips? Specifically, the tips. So we will discuss on column chromatography. And the next you phase, that will cover your rotary evaporator, and different techniques and tips related to the evaporation process in the rotary evaporator. Okay? So today we are going to start the first session of our first program, that is your hands-on training on column chromatography. So I welcome you on behalf of the Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences, and I request you one thing, that you go to the ISTEM portal. ISTEM, as you have, some of you have registered, some of you have applied online also. So lot of your tools, lot of instruments are available in the portal. You can have the facility that is your offered by ISTEM throughout the lesson, through different your expert talks and your trainings. So you can avail that facility, you can directly talk with your expert, and you will learn whatever problem, because we have many new research scholars, and each research scholar has your specific issues, specific problems related to his own research. So you can directly talk with an expert who is related to your research area or who is related to your research or your study. Okay? So you encourage your friends also, encourage your colleagues to register in ISTEM portal to avail the instruments. Okay? Now, what is your chromatography? If you have any, you suppose, theoretical idea, that chromatography chrome means color, and your graphic is that. Actually, it was invented, this particular technique was invented by an Italian born pure scientist, Russian scientist, in 1900. So, this technique was used to separate your chlorophyll or other your plant pigments, showing different color bands. And when you show different color bands, it appears. So that you will from that the term chromatography has developed. So later on, so considering the utility or possibility of its use in drug or population development or different area, especially where separation technique is necessary. Separation your technique is necessary. We want to separate some phytoconstituent from a mixer. We want to separate one chemical, particular chemical from a mixture of your suppose chemicals. So in those you suppose fields, this particular separation technology, chromatography techniques, so that has been employed, and gradually it has developed from the basic stage to nowadays we have high performance liquid chromatography, we have gas chromatography, we have your diffusion chromatography, we have your thin layer chromatography, so many you suppose can be. Now if you see that main principle in chromatography is separation based on its affinity. So it may be affinity towards one stationary phase, or it may absolutely. So we have whatever kind of constituents we have, it may be alkaloid, it may be glycoside, it may be eugenic, it may be eugenolic compound. So each and every component has different solubility in different pure solvent. And if we see the solvent, solvent means water is also solvent, alcohol is also solvent, your butanol is also solvent, chloroform is also solvent, hexane is also solvent, your ethyl acetate is also solvent. You have different solvents. And those solvents, they exhibit their polarity through each your main group, key group layer is electron. Now if we see that in every your chemical compound, whether in chemical reaction, whether in your suppose you reduce reaction or all you suppose physical or chemical behavior, including covalent bonding. So always the key player is the reaction. Even in human physiological system also, the key player is reaction. If we touch, mosquito is biting, so everything is related to you, suppose electric current behavior. Sodium ion is moving, electric potassium ion, sodium ion, chloride. So all these things actually related to electrical impulse for actually the role of electric. Now based on this, whatever solvents we are using, so these solvents exhibit different polarity. Now as a you suppose basic principle, so polar solvent will dissolve polar substances and non-polar solvent will dissolve your non-polar substances. So this principle we can utilize to separate polar substances from a mixer or non-polar substance from a mixer. If you selectively use different solvents based on polarity, suppose non-polar solvent we use at first, then gradually you will increase the polarity, then equally you suppose the substances in relation to that polarity will be eluted, because how will be separated. Now column chromatography is based on adsorption. If we have one mixture of substances, if we have one mixture of different pure compounds, it may be one chemical mixture, or it may be one reaction mixture, or it may be one hypochemical pure extract. We will place that one, and whatever constituents are there, that your chemical substances are there, they will have different affinity towards the stationary phase. In column chromatography column, we will use stationary phase. Stationary phase, it will remain your stable. It will remain stable, and we will place the mixer on top, and it will have different your absorption, different affinity towards the stationary phase. The substance which is having worst affinity will come out as soon as we add the mobile phase solvent. When we will add the mobile phase solvent, then the substance which has your worst affinity, it will come out and you can collect it. And the substance which is having your highest affinity towards the stationary phase will come out at last stage. This means we can have your suppose each and every component based on your absorption affinity, we can collect separately each and every component. There may be 30 your suppose constituents, there may be 40 constituents, but we can separate it and we can evaporate the solvent, we can get the ratio, we can go for further studies, subsequent studies. So that is why we are using or we are taking this particular technique, because this is very much common in phytochemical screening. Now when we extract, as we have given our agenda, that we suppose extraction processes. Now when we carry out any extraction, means we are trying to collect the phyto constituents from your plant. We want to collect some constituents from your animal. We can have some reaction mixture. We can have some substances out of your suppose fermentation process or bioreactor. So this means when we go for extraction, when we say the term extraction, basically it is related with plant. you can have leaves, you can have bark, you can have seed, you can have fruits, you can have, you suppose, other substances, and from there we will extract. What we will extract? We will extract the constituents present in the part of the plant. For that we have, you suppose, different extraction processes. We have maceration process, we have percolation process, we have infusion, we have decoction. So we have, you suppose, hot continuous extraction process, choxidation. So in that way we have different extraction processes. And based on the chemical nature of the compound, if the substance is thermolabile, we will not go for hot extraction process. If we are having, you suppose, some volatile component, either we can go for, you suppose, say, hydrodistillation method, volatile oil, or if we can go for your own maceration process. Okay? Now, after maceration, this medium maceration or after that extraction process, because the extraction process means whatever solvent we will be using, it may be composed, it may be one single solvent or it may be mixture of solvents. When we will be using that solvent, it will dissolve all the constituents on the basis of the solubility. Highest your soluble substance will get dissolved first, and gradually, depending on the dissolving capacity of the solvent, it will extract, means leaching out. Solvent will penetrate the cell, cancel, it will dissolve the constituent, then it will come out from the cell. That is what that phenomenon is known as your leaching. Okay? Now, that you suppose your particular process, by that process we are extracting the constituents from your plant cells. After extraction, we need to separate, we need to study what are the constituents present in that extract. Because in drug development process or any new development of your pharmaceuticals, we need to separate the constituents to study its physical behavior, to study its chemical behavior, and to basically to identify the compound present in that particular plant parts. So, this your introductory, discussion, after this, we will have the instrument in front of us, the apparatus, column. So, columns are different size. It may be from your this much small to your suppose very, very big. You will have the exposure to the column, different columns. And how to pack it, how to handle it, what are the problems associated during your, when you will be using your column chromatography, all these things will be discussed in the subsequent your session. Okay? So, this is your. For introductory, you suppose you discussion on extraction process, and I am handing over the next session. To Neelutpal. So Neelutpal will have hands-on training in the laboratory where instrument, the apparatus will be there in front of us, and he will show what are the problems associated with the apparatus. And how to deal with them, how to pack, how, what are the problems, how to solve it, he will discuss and he will train you up, you will be allowed to handle also, you will be allowed to handle also, and you will learn something. The objective of this to make you not theoretical knowledge, practically you should learn and you should handle that. Okay, thank you very much and wish you all the best. This
regarding the this basic chromatography technique. So this column chromatography technique is a very basic version of all kinds of chromatography technique, which mainly we are here using for isolation of compound from plant extract. And it can also be used for purification of synthesized compound which are synthesized by chemists or medicinal chemists as per their requirement. So regarding the column chromatography technique or chromatography technique, I think that you have already studied, or if you are not studied, then you have to go through that part in your theory part, because it will be not possible to describe everything here. Mainly I am going to show here that how we are preparing
this column for heating, for loading the sample for separation or for isolation of compound, and later on which are the factors that we have to remember during preparation of this column. Because although it looks very small, but during the preparation of this column we have to consider so many factors. Otherwise, what will happen during our separation time? We are not going to get the separation of our desired compound, or there will be some less separation, or there the separation or the resolution of the band that will be appear in this column that will be very less. So there are different kind of column based on depending upon our aim and objectives we have to select. So in case of plant related sample, when we go for isolation of a compound from an extract, then first we use a very bigger size of column. So here it is actually right now it is not present, that column. These are some smaller version of column which we use for fractionation or separation of compound after preliminary fractionation with the bigger bigger column. So I think that big column is present. So after extraction, if you are going with extraction, then after you have selected a particular extract, that from this extract I am going to isolate compound. So we directly cannot use that particular extract in a small column. The first thing is that in that particular extract, the amount of compound going to be present, it will be very less. So to get a compound in sufficient quantity, because after isolation of the compound, we have to characterize that compound also. Because otherwise, if we are going to get a very less amount of compound, if we are not able to characterize that one, then it will be useless. So for that purpose, sometimes we require minimum 50 mg of compound. And to get that 50 mg of compound, we have to take minimum 70 to 80 gram of extract, and that 70 to 80 gram of extract we cannot load directly in this particular small column. So for that purpose, initially that extract we have to take in this bigger column. So after separating the extract with different solvent system using this bigger column, whatever the fractions we are going to get, that fraction later on we are again separating with this small column, because the 80 mg or that 80 gram extract initially we have taken, after separation we are going to get like 6 gram or 4 gram or 3 gram of fractions. That means there are semi purified fractions where some compounds based on their solubility it will be separated, and in next phase we are going to separate those fractions to individual compounds using this small columns. So that is the basic procedure we utilize here. But it is not like that after getting the fraction from this bigger column, when we are going to run that fraction using this small column, it will be completely purified. Most of the time it is 70 to 80% purified. If we need to purify up to 90%, because 100% purification is not possible. So if we need further purification up to 90-95%, then we have to go for preparative SPLC, preparative SPTLC, that modern analytical technique. So using those techniques, further we can purify our compound up to 90-95% like that. That is why regarding isolation of compound from plant extract, it is a very tedious job. Means it looks very small job, like simply we have to run a column, but that whole procedure actually it going to take time. Like depending upon the nature of the extract you have chosen, depending upon the compound you are looking for, so based on all these factors it may take up to 6 months, 7 months, or you may get a compound within 1 month or it's like that. So when we first going to prepare a column, there are two basic techniques which we utilize. One is dry filling, one is wet filling. So I am going to demonstrate both these two techniques, what is wet filling and what is dry filling. So this chromatographic technique you can call is a preparative technique, because here we have to prepare the column by ourselves. but regarding preparative HPTLC or preparative HPLC, there the column is ready-made because the stationary phase which is required for separation of the compound, it is already present or it is already applied or it is loaded inside the column by the manufacturer. But here what we have to do, we have to prepare, we have to load the stationary phase by ourselves. That is why it is called as a preparative column chromatography process also. So now I am going to show you how we are going to fill or load this column with silica gel. So when here I have fit these two columns with the stand, but during fitting we have to consider also one thing, that whether this particular column is properly perpendicular or not. Because if suppose column is going to present like this, so what will happen? It will be present in inclined position. So when you are going to pour the solvent, when it will be separated, so what will happen? The mixer will be separated in this particular way only. So ultimately we are not going to get a good separation of this particular fraction or that particular extract. So first, when we are going to fit this column in the stand, we have to see whether this particular column is properly fitted or whether it is remain perpendicular or not. If not, we have to adjust it, otherwise we will not going to get a good separation. So this is the column. Now we are going to use silica gel to fill this particular column. So there are different kind of, not different kind, different size of, mesh size of silica gel. So based on our requirement, we have to choose which one we are going to use. So these two silica gel, this is 100 to 200 mesh size, and this is 60 to 120 mesh size. So 60 to 120 mesh size means the particle size of this particular silica gel is large. It is 250 micrometer to 125 micrometer. And regarding this 100 to 200 micrometer mesh size, the particle size will be 120 micrometer to 75 micrometer. So that means the particle size of this particular silica gel is less in comparison to this 60 to 120 mesh size. And again, which one we are going to use for chromatographic technique, that will be depend what sample we are going to use. And one important thing regarding these two silica gel is that they are going to work under gravitational force. That means once we are going to use this particular silica gel in our column, then we don't need to press, apply external pressure to flow the solvent through the column. But if we are going to use higher mesh size of silica gel, like silica gel 200 to 400 or silica gel 230 to 400, then these two silica gel mainly used for flash chromatography, where we need to apply external pressure to flow the solvent system through the column. So mainly in our purpose, we use these two size of silica gel only. So when we go for preliminary fractionation of plain extract, then first we use this particular silica gel 60 to 120 mesh size, and after getting the fraction, after preliminary fractionation, whatever the fraction we are going to get, when we are going to harder fractionation or isolation of compound using small column, at that time we use this 100 to 200 mesh size silica gel. And these two silica gel, these are polar in nature. That means in our column chromatography, this in this stationary phase, it will going to act as a polar stationary phase. So there are two kind of stationary phase, or there are two kind of chromatography technique we can able to see. One is normal chromatography, where the stationary phase will be your polar, and the mobile phase, that means the solvent we are going to use to elute the extract or elute the fraction, that will be non-polar. And in the reverse case, if we want to perform reverse phase chromatography, at that time the stationary phase it will be non-polar and the mobile phase it will be polar. And that two kind of chromatography, which one we are going to use, it will be depend upon the nature of our extract or the nature of our compound that we are going to purify or separate it in our column. Basically, in case of plant extract or plant sample, mainly we go up to methanol extract. Methanol is a mid-polar solvent system, so in that case we can utilize this normal chromatography only, where we use this polar silica gel as a stationary phase and we are going to use non-polar solvent system to elute the extract or fractions. But if our nature of extract is very polar, suppose it is a water extract or hydroalcoholic extract, at that time we may need to follow reverse phase chromatography. So depending upon that thing, we have to choose the stationary phase and mobile phase accordingly. So now I'm going to demonstrate you how to fill this column. Please switch off it. So first, when we are preparing for column chromatography, we have to see what is the size or what is the amount of sample we have. Regarding plant extract, we may have 100 gram or we may have 150 gram, we may have 60 gram. But at the same time, we have to see whatever the column we are going to use, what should be its maximum capacity. Because suppose if we are going to use this column for fractionation of plant extract, we can use maximum up to 80 gram or most suitably 60 to 70 gram. But here if we want to fill it with 100 gram or 150 gram, then it will not going to work properly. Because once we are going to increase the amount of the sample, that means we have to increase the size of the sample here. Once the size of the sample will be increased, that means the separation will be not going to be proper. That's why we have to keep minimum amount of sample in the column so that we can able to get maximum separation or better separation during the chromatography process. And at the same time, we have to also see what will be the length of the stationary phase that we are going to use. Suppose this is the column. So up to which portion we have to fill? Because when we are going to fill this particular column, we have to consider that we have to fill with the silica, which is going to act as stationary phase. Then we have to add our sample. Then we have to keep mobile phase in this portion. Suppose we have coated our silica gel up to this. That means this particular area will going to act as a stationary phase. Then we have filled our sample up to this. Then only this portion will be left for adding the mobile phase. That means it is not going to be proper way. Because this amount of mobile phase, you have to very frequently have to add this. And this amount of length, when the sample will start to run, to separate or to pass through this particular length of this stationary phase, it will going to take very long time. And that's where when we are going to fill the column with the stationary phase, we have to consider that thing also, that what should be the maximum length of that particular stationary phase. So when we used to fill the column, so based on the diameter, we particularly used to select that we are going to add our stationary phase up to this length. So this is a small column. So if in this small column I am going to fill up to this, then I have to apply sample up to this, and only this amount will be left to add the mobile phase. Then it will be not going to work. It will work, it will going to take
very long time for separation, and at the same time you have to sit near to it, because once you are going to start the process, that means very frequently we will have to add the mobile phase to here, but it should not be like that. There should be sufficient space for at least you have to add minimum, in this case you have to add minimum 300 to 400 ml of mobile phase, and here at least you have to add 50 to 60 ml of mobile phase, so that actually you get some time, or the column also get time to properly separate the compound. And when we going to fill up this particular column, any column, not this one, whatever it is, first we have to take the measurement that up to which length we are going to fill up that particular column. Scale is there, so the scale. So this is the mini column, actually this is mainly we use for purification of compound, either synthetic compound or either fraction of nacelle extract. So here I am going to fill this column up to, it will be depends how much amount of sample I have. So if this is the amount of sample I have, this is a fraction that I have prepared with silica gel for loading in column. So if this amount of extract is present, then filling up to 10 cm will be sufficient for me. Marker is there. So this is 12 cm, but I have taken a little bit time, because after I am going to mix slurry with the solvent, it will be settled down. That means the void that right now present inside or within the silica gel particle, it will be filled up and it will be a little bit settled down. So this is 12 cm, so I have taken a little bit higher. So now I am going to So when we are going to prepare the slurry, so again we have to consider one thing, that from which solvent system we are going to start the chromatographic process. So normally in case of our plain extract, we start with the very non-polar, that is either it will be hexane or either it will be pentane. So considering that situation, I am preparing this column. So I am going to prepare the slurry to fill up this column with the stationary base. I am starting with petroleum benzene or petroleum ether. It is the highest, most non-polar solvent system. So I have taken the silica gel which is required to fill this column up to this mark, and after that I have transferred that amount to this beaker, and then I have added this petroleum benzene or petroleum ether to make the slurry, because I am not actually. It will be, you can use 1:6 ratio, 1:5 like this. So I have almost taken this around 30, 40, so I have 100. So after adding this, I have to stir it properly so that if any air bubble that might present inside the particle that are going to remove. You have to stir this particular slurry as much as possible so that there are very less amount of air gap or void present between the silica particles. But it will not guarantee that when I am going to fill this one, there will be no bubble or there will be no air gap. So that's why after filling this column also, I have to wait for at least 5 to 6 hours so that silica will be properly settled. So in this bigger size of column, after filling this column, we have to wait sometimes 2-3 days so that the silica will properly settle. But in this case of small column, within 2-3 hours, it will settle down. Theoretically, suppose if we want to run this particular column initially with ethyl acetate. So ethyl acetate is a mid-polar solvent system. So
if we want to start, if we want to start the running process with calicylated micelle, so theoretically we should fill this particular column first with calicylate. But practically we don't do that, because practically if we going to run this particular column with ethylacetate also, practically we prepare a slurry with either petroleum ether or hexanone. After that, what we used to do, we used to replace that particular petroleum ether with ethylacetate. So that means before adding sample, after loading the column with silica gel with petroleum ether, and before adding our sample to that particular column, we have to gradually replace that PET ether or hexane with ethylacetate. When it will be completely replaced with ethylacetate, the whole column, then we are going to load our sample.
In that case, we have to manually add this particular supporting system to that particular column.
sometimes we used to put first photon here, after that some sand, after the body washing we can remove to use that. But where we have, when we have purchased this particular column, we have considered that this we have means fix this supporting system. This material of the waste. Actually this is made up of plastic only. Means it is a internal material which is not going to react with any solvent. Means it is not going to affect the separation or nature of the compound of any kind. So now I am going to fill this particular column up to this portion by dry filling technique.
That's why, suppose you have taken 120 gram of sample, for loading in column.
For that 120 gram of sample, you may require 50 gram or like sometimes 30 gram of silica. So at that time, what will happen? That particular sample will be going to take this much amount of length within the column. That will be useless.
What about the liquid?
You can also prepare. Okay. You have to take the liquid sample, you have to add the silica, and then you have to stir it, and you have to, because it will be liquid sample, so no need to add any external solvent. Directly you can add silica, you have to stir it, and once it will come like this, so you can add that particular sample. Here first we have to fill up our column with the solvent, then we have to add the silica. So when we are going to add the silica, we have not to be careful, because if we are going to pour the whole silica at a time, what will happen? There will be huge air gap that will be present inside the column, and it will ultimately going to hamper, or it may not going to settle properly after 4-5 days. We have to wait. Means after adding some amount, we have to wait. We have to see whether it is properly. Then we have to wait. That means edit.
charger the charger.
This is how we used to load the spirits. This is that was the weight filling and this was the dry filling. So from tomorrow onwards you are practically going to fill this column. We are moving this material, then you will have to prepare the slurry or you have to fill the stationary test to that particular column.